Good morning.
Good morning.
We're going to kick things off with a song of praise. How great is our God? And if y'all want to stand and join us, we'd love for you to.
Are you watching the one there?
The splendor of the
How great you are, O God, and we are so thankful to be in a place that is set aside to worship you. We thank you for our faith family with whom we gather, for we know that we are better together. And on this weekend in our nation's history, when we stop to mark out 20 years since tragedy struck, we thank you that you are a God that rebuilds. You're a God of second chances. You're a God of grace and mercy in our time of need. And so meet us in this place as we come transform our hearts and lives, that we, together, might shine your light into all the world. We pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, well, we're going to have a musical, a song of praise, Amazing Grace, My Chains Are Gone. Won't you stand and sing with us? Thanks for your grace for us as we sing and this morning, and know that it is a joy to have folks like James and Jim to step up and sing. If you look behind me, our choir is out of town. I think they're on tour, Janice, most of them. I think most of them are on tour down at the beach and enjoying the sunshine, but we're thankful to have folks to step in and lead us in a time of song. This has been a heavy weekend. I don't know if you spent some time watching the news in the last couple of days, watching tributes, reflecting on two decades since a day that none of us will ever forget. And I'm mindful that some don't even remember it. In fact, my household full of young'uns, 9/11/01 is history. Many of my soldiers weren't born when that day happened, and yet now they serve our nation. Some of our youngest police officers and firefighters and emergency responders weren't alive on that day. And that's hard to imagine, because to me it seems like it was just yesterday. And so, as we reflect, oftentimes frustration and hurt and anger and grief wells up. And all of those are normal feelings, and they're good feelings, but they also remind us, I believe, of our need to confess. For even as our hearts were broken on that day, each of us in our journeys falls short of God's intent for us, and we stumble and bumble through life, sometimes causing pain, even when we don't know it. And so may our pain and grief remind us of our need for God's grace. And I invite you to join me in this unison prayer of confession as we enter into a time of prayer. Won't you lift your voices with me? Awesome God, you have made all of creation and each cell of our bodies. You know our thoughts and you know our sins. We desperately try to hide our mistakes, our weaknesses, our embarrassments. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. But you know it all. And so we come before you now, asking for your forgiveness. Even as you know the limits of our human capabilities, we know the unlimited power of your love. Forgive us, cleanse us, make us whole. Amen. The need for God's grace, for our chains to be taken away. We all have it. And he tells us that in confession, we find it. As we confess our sins, Scripture tells us he is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Sometimes our attitude toward confession is like kids' attitude toward taking a bath. Do I have to? Why do I? I just took one yesterday. You ever hear that? Well, can I take it tomorrow? I don't really stink. Our attitudes to confession are somewhat like that. And so thanks for joining me in that prayer of confession. Well, there are a lot of needs I know that you bring and of which I'm aware in prayer, but I want to ask you the question that we seek to answer every week, and that is, where have you seen God at work in this past week? Miss Jackie. In the gift of life, a new great grandbaby. Awesome. A boy or girl?
It's a girl.
Little girl.
Malin Marie.
Malin Marie, the little M&M, and she's 8 pounds, 8 ounces, and we are thankful for new life. Where else have y'all seen God at work? Butch.
Helping hands at the fair.
Yeah. Y'all, for how many years now? About six, seven? About 7 years, we've partnered with other churches in the community to welcome our guests. The county fair shows up, but in case you didn't know it, nobody from Cumberland County helps put it on, really. Don't let them hear me say that. But the actual fair workers are what we call carnies. They travel the country and put on these carnivals. And life is tough, and it's a place where a lot of folks go when they're not sure what else to do. They're on the road. And when they show up to Fayetteville, as Shane and Butch and Grady heard yesterday, they say every time they come to Fayetteville, they feel loved and welcomed. One lady even said, hey, when I'm back, I'd love to visit your church. I remember this place. I remember these people. I remember the pickle man, right? And the folks that come and offer them a sandwich and a bottle of cold water on a hot day. A gift of hospitality that says thank you. And so we celebrate that ministry. Robert, where have you seen God at work?
So challenging times at work every day. And then God gives you strength and guidance to pull through. And then he
Yeah. For those of you at home that couldn't hear that, Robert works at Haymount Nursing Home on Bragg Boulevard or just off that. And every day walks alongside folks at difficult times in their journey, the end of their life, working with staff that are trying to keep COVID out and away and keep people healthy. And he sees up close and personal the struggles that you and I watch on TV. And so we're thankful for the strength that he has there. But also he gave thanks for the opportunity to come and worship. What a gift it is. And we can see God in one another. Where else have you seen God at work? Miss Peggy. Survivors who have the courage to share their stories, both from 9/11 and any time. What a powerful witness, because it inspires us that even in the midst of tragedy, there is hope. I encourage folks on my social media accounts and with my Army chaplain team yesterday that when I think back of 9/11, I think of Daniel chapter 3, and Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego standing in the fiery furnace. And when Nebuchadnezzar saw them there, he knew he had thrown three folks into the furnace. He said, but it looks as if there's four, and the fourth one is a son of God. It reminds me that God shows up in the fires. And I think we are the church best when we show up in those fiery days for others. And we stand alongside them in the heat of the moment. So, look for God, even in the tough times. Mr. Rogers used to say, look for the helpers. Turn and find the helpers. They're there to help you. God is there to provide a helping hand. There's also a lot of needs for which we need to pray, and I'm going to share a few of them with you this morning. We got word yesterday that Ms. Barbara Cullen, who had not been doing real well health-wise, took her final breaths yesterday at Hope Mills Nursing Home and died after living a great life of filled with music and joy. And just be in prayer for her family. Most of them are not nearby, but we want to just lift them up as they come and make arrangements to celebrate her life. And so as we find out more about that, we'll let you know. But for all who knew and loved Barbara, she was the choir director at First Baptist of Hope Mills for a lot of years, and then sang in our choir and was part of our super seniors group and Joy Sunday School class, and just a super amazing lady. So lift up her family if you would, and just, as I said, found that out last night. I know there are some that continue to battle health issues and have tests and await results. What else can we be praying for this morning? Any prayer requests? And if you're at home, you can put those into the comments on Facebook. I want to give thanks that Danny and Karen's newest grandbaby is home. She was a super preemie, and she's now almost reached what her expected birth weight was, and she's back at home with her mama, which is good. I want to be lifting up Karen as she cares for her dad. Yes, for those of you that know Joyce, she has had all kinds of surgeries and tests and was in Duke, and she's back home feeling better and hopefully gaining strength day by day. And for that, we're thankful. Brady was able to come and help with the fair ministry, so that means Joyce is doing pretty well. Yes, ma'am. Yeah, we want to continue to lift up Jim's mom and Mark's mom. So many are in what we call the sandwich generation, caring for aging parents and trying to also encourage growing kids, and that's a difficult task a lot of days. And so we want to lift up both Jim's mom, but also Jim and Doris as they seek to care for her. But won't you join me in prayer this morning? God, we give you thanks that we can pause and pray, and that you promise that you'll hear our prayers. We don't always know the words to share. We don't even know how to express all that's on our heart. But we come knowing that you know better than we. You've heard the names we've lifted up. We ask your care and compassion. We ask for your strength and your healing and your hope for those grieving and hurting and struggling. And God, we ask that you would bring healing and hope to our nation, that this anniversary of tragedy would remind us of just how fragile our lives and our freedoms are. God, may we have eyes to see and ears to hear and hearts to join you, for you're at work all around us. Help us to live moment by moment and day by day, even as we lift up the words that Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Well, I invite you to stand as you're able and lift up this wonderful hymn, Immortal, Invisible, God Only Wise. It's a hymn of reflection this morning. Why don't you stand and sing with us? A new start, for we're back in the beginning. The way in which I plan my sermons is through a wonderful gift, I believe, to the church called the Narrative Lectionary. And you may remember about 6 years ago, we did a series called The Story, the Bible as a Narrative. And so often we grab a verse and we talk about it, but we have no idea how that fits into what was going on 1,000 years before and what was happening 500 years later. We just grab it and take it and run with it. And we miss the connection. And so the Narrative Lectionary starts each year right after Labor Day, this weekend, in Genesis. And takes us through what I just finished last week, which is Revelation. And it says, how does this story of God and God's people connect? And it goes through Scripture that way, year after year after year. Now, you don't always get the connection, and I don't always make the connection well. But that's why we're back to Genesis, in the beginning, to hear about God starting it all. And so hear now the Word of God from the beginning, from Genesis 1 and a couple verses from 2, and then some verses from the New Testament as well. First this, God created the heavens and earth, all you see, all you don't see. Earth was a soup of nothingness, a bottomless emptiness, an inky blackness. God's Spirit brooded or hovered like a bird above the watery abyss. God spoke light, and light appeared. God saw that light was good and separated light from dark. God named the light day, and he named the dark night. And it was evening. It was morning. Day one. Now from Genesis 2. Heaven and earth were finished. Down to the last detail. And now from John chapter 1. The Word was first. The Word present to God. God present to the Word. The Word was God in readiness for God from day one. Everything was created through him. Nothing, not one thing, came into being without him. What came into existence was life. And the life was light to live by. The life light blazed out of the darkness. The darkness couldn't put it out. And now 2 Corinthians 5. Because of this decision to follow Jesus, we don't evaluate people by what they have or how they look. We looked at the Messiah that way once and got it all wrong, as you know. We certainly don't look at it that way anymore. Now we look inside. And what we see is that anyone united with the Messiah gets a fresh start, is created new. Or as you may know it, anyone in Christ is a new creation. The Word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. As we prepare to break open that Word, hear this beautiful chorus called Breathe. A reminder that the very air that we breathe is a gift from God. That the Spirit that hovered and the breath that God offered in creation are the same Word.
Mm-hmm.
Well, thanks, gentlemen. If you haven't tried singing in a microphone in front of people, it's harder than you think. But we invite you to come and join us at some point. In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. It says God spoke with words he created. Words matter, don't they? And you've heard me say multiple times from this very spot that what we teach our kids about words just isn't true. Sticks and stones can break my bones, but words can break my heart. That's what we need to teach. But we teach them words will never hurt me. And so they take the words that are poured into them and they shove them deep within them, and what happens someday? They explode. For words create. What we pour in, what words we pour into people, help them create who they are. In fact, a child doesn't know their own name until it's spoken to them, right? You are, and your family gives you a name. And with that, you have an identity. And words matter, for over time, people begin to tell you, you know, you're so strong. You're so smart. You're so pretty or handsome. You're so funny. You're so gifted at this. In the beginning, God spoke and he created. And we like to create, don't we? I don't know about you, but I want to try something a whole lot easier than singing into a microphone in front of people. I want to play with some blocks this morning. One of the first things that kids do is pick things up. And they throw them, and what else they do? Stick them in their mouth, and they lick them. They try to figure out what they are, but pretty soon they begin to want to build things up. It says, in the beginning, God created. Now let's try this. And he stacked all the things in the right places. It says he created the heavens and the earth. And the Spirit of God, same word for spirit and breath, hovered over the creation. And he created. And he continued to create and put things as they should be. And what did he say about it? It was good. But what happened? All that was good didn't stay that way. On September 10th, 2001, we had built things and felt like all was good in the world. But just as happened in creation, the next morning it happened in our world in a way we had never seen, and the towers came down. Whether you're alive for that event or not, you know what it feels like, because you've built before. You've created, and some bully kid came and knocked your blocks down. Y'all know what I'm talking about? It happens. And life is about a series over and over of things that happen to us when we build, and that which we build is torn down. We learn it when we're little. What do we do when the bully knocks our blocks over? We got to figure out the next steps. And we have to decide if we just wallow in the rubble or if we take some kind of action to begin again. God spoke into creation and it was good. And we too create so much that is good. But when that creation fell, when those things that we create fall, that we rear in our homes and our kids go off and it doesn't end up the way we expected it to. What do we do? What do we do? Words matter. And God spoke and he breathed and life happened. And it was good. But then it wasn't. And this weekend, we know what that's like in a collective way. What do we do now? And I don't know about you, but I've heard time and again folks say, you know, I remember September 12th, 2001, oh so well. Why? Because people that didn't know each other came together to try to make things better. Now, it wasn't all a bed of roses, because friends of mine that don't look like me were suddenly labeled and targeted, and they were more patriotic than I ever was, because we didn't know how to respond when things were broken. What do kids do when their blocks get knocked down? Yeah, they might build again. The first thing they probably do is cry. You ever see that happen? Grant knocked my blocks down. Right? Get angry and frustrated. They might even pick up a block and throw it at the bully. What's the bully do? Laugh, usually. And so we're stuck with a choice. What do we do? How do we rebuild? In the beginning, God created and it was good, but then it wasn't, and we create and it's good. And then, like what happened in the garden, there's a fall. Like what happened on 9/11, there's a fall, and we have to decide what happens next. And if we were just sitting there in the rubble of our blocks by ourselves, we might choose to just sit there forever. Listen to what the New Testament tells us. In 2 Corinthians 5:17, it says, if anyone is in Christ, he or she is a new creation. The old is gone. All things have become new. God didn't just create and leave it there. He created and he continues to create as his breath and his word speaks into us. How did that new creation happen? It said in John 1, in the beginning was the Word. And the Word was with God, and the Word was God, and nothing was created except through him. New creation comes through Jesus as we begin to see the full extent of God's love. So what are we called to do? God spoke into creation and it was good, but then it wasn't. Creation fell, and so too do the things we create. And I don't just mean towers. Relationships fall. Jobs fall. Finances fall. Churches fall. Expectations fall. So much of what we create falls, and life is about what we do after the fall. And the gospel is that God says, I create anew. I create anew. And so he says, if anyone is in Christ, he or she's a new creation. And that means that the blocks are stacked again. And God says, I do that again with my word. This time, not my word spoken, but my word become what? Flesh. Lived among you, that you would see my love for you, and in seeing it, you would have the courage to build your life again and anew. And he says, we are called to be like Jesus. And if that's what we're called to be, then what are we supposed to do? He was the what? The Word. The Word become flesh that made, woo, things new. So if we're to be like him, we have to help make things new in the lives of others. Y'all are focusing way too much on me not making this thing sound bad. But remember, when we built the towers, we rebuilt them differently. So, we're called to be like Jesus, to be the Word made flesh that makes things new. See, God puts his big hands around us and holds on. There we go. So how do we do that? How are we the Word made flesh? I don't think it's by hollering Bible verses at people. That's the Word screamed out. I don't know that it's just inviting folks to join us in worship, although that's a great thing. See, the Word become flesh did what? The message says it came and moved into the neighborhood. That's what incarnation is. Becoming flesh, moving into the neighborhood. And we, if we're to be like Jesus, are called to use our words to help create and recreate. And so when we encounter someone whose towers have fallen, what are we supposed to do? What do you do when you come and a bully's knocked down a little boy or girl's blocks? What's the first thing that we do? Words of what? Words of comfort. Oh, hey, Ted, buddy, it'll be okay. Right? But if we tell them it'll be okay and we walk away, what do they learn?
Nothing.
It won't be okay. And that adult lied to me. Right? Our words have to match our actions. And in the beginning, God spoke and he created and it was good and he breathed breath, and our breath has to match our words. We have to come and breathe new life into broken lives all around us. If we're to be like Jesus, we have to realize that our words matter and our breath matters, and we have to speak them and breathe them into lives and help put the bricks back together. We come and we offer words of comfort. The next thing we do with a child whose blocks have fallen is the thing we need to do in lives as well. Oh, buddy, I'm so sorry, it'll be okay. Then we do something powerful. We ask a question, usually. What happened? If we're going to have words that speak life, we've got to learn more questions. We've got to learn more questions. We've got to learn to ask the people who are broken about them. Tell me your story. Because if we act without asking, what tends to happen? We may be the wrong thing. We may have the whole situation completely wrong. Maybe the blocks have been knocked down because the little person wants to start over. We don't know. So we got to ask. And if we ask, our words need to be filled with questions and then with quiet so we can hear the answer. What happened? And 20 years after our towers fell, we're still asking that question. What happened? And we still don't have all the answers. Yeah, we know what happened that morning, but what led to that? And how did we get there? And what actions of ours might have caused somebody to be that frustrated? What could we have done to prevent? How about our reaction since? And what could we have been? We begin to ask these questions, and the only way to learn is to be quiet after we ask the question. Words matter, and our questions matter, and our quiet after the question matters, so that people can share their broken stories with us. And finally, our words need to be encouraging. As we hear the story, the little person tells us that the bully knocked down their blocks, then we have a choice to make. And we've heard the story and we comfort them, and we have to decide what happens next. Our encouraging words that can create. I think you can build that back. And we speak life and creation into the brokenness. can't walk away after that. They need to feel our breath, even as at creation, it was God's breath that followed God's words to make things come alive. And we sit down in the rubble and we grab the pieces and we tremble and try to put them back together again. In the beginning, God created and it was good, and then it wasn't. Life is like that. In the beginning, it's good. Woo! And then it isn't. But then it is again. Because God says, as you come to me and follow Christ, you are made new again. And we're big on come to Jesus and follow him, and he'll forgive you of your sins. Once saved, always saved, and that's awesome. But that doesn't mean things won't break the very next day, does it? Doesn't mean there still won't be towers that fall and blocks that are knocked down and things in your life that were good that now aren't and that are broken. And so we're called then to try to figure out what to do next. God says, I'm right here. I, the word that was spoken and made creation, have come to you, and I'm promising that I'll make you new. Y'all, there's a world that desperately needs to know that when things fall, that there's somebody there to ask a question, to be quiet enough to listen, to offer words of encouragement, and to stand alongside them close enough for them to feel our breath, that we can help them put the blocks back together again. To create and recreate. And when we do that, when our words match God's, when our breath matches God's, when we show up in the rubble, guess who they see in us? They see God. It's a powerful challenge. And so my challenge to you today is to know that no matter what's broken in your life, you have a God that says, I step into your world, and I want to make things new. I created you in my image at the beginning, and it was good. Now not so much. But in Christ, I'm making you new again. That's the message we have for the world. But they'll never know it if we don't show up with the words. The words that Jesus would have used. You know that more times than not, he asked a question than gave an answer? Isn't that amazing? I'm going to study that in a few weeks on Wednesday nights. More times Jesus spoke asking a question than giving an answer. May our words ask good questions. May our words encourage. May our words create anew, even as we stand alongside folks in times of brokenness. For in so doing, they will see in us the image of God as we see it in them as well. Let's pray together. God, thank you for hearing our prayer. Thank you that when you created, you said it was good. And then when it wasn't so good, you didn't leave it that way. But you spoke with action. Oh, may we do the same. May we know that in our brokenness, you show up. And you help us put the pieces back together. You weep with us. You hold us. You ask questions of us. You listen to us. You encourage us. And you make us new. Even as you've done that for us, may we do it for others. for the world created in your image that is good is oh so broken. Give us the courage to be your word become flesh, even as Jesus was. And to know that we're hard pressed on every side, but not crushed. And may we share that with others. That we may be perplexed, but we're not in despair. That we may feel persecuted, but we're never abandoned. Struck down, but in you we're not destroyed. But instead, we are made new. For this, we give you thanks and ask for the courage to bring that message to the world, now and always. Amen and amen. Our hymn of commitment today reminds us that when we do this together, we have a greater impact. Our God has made us one. Folks, if you ask people in your life and in our world how they view the church in America, they may not quote the words to this song. But if we live the words to this song, we'll begin to be those vessels of new creation. The word become flesh as we are one. Let's stand and sing together. If God speaks to you in a special way this morning, come and share that with us. Let us pray with you. Our God has made us one. Come alongside and help us rebuild. A couple announcements before we go. Put it on your calendar. October the 10th is not only my dad's birthday, but it's our homecoming Sunday. And we're going to celebrate. We're going to worship just as we are. We invite you to invite folks that have been connected to Mount Pisgah in any way to come back home. And then as we always do on homecoming, we're going to celebrate with a meal. I believe our deacons have decided that we're going to serve that meal, get your plate full of food in the fellowship hall, and then eat in the beauty of Eastern North Carolina fall weather outside at the picnic tables, under the tree, in the shade, have a dinner on the grounds, but we need your help to provide that meal. And so we're excited about that homecoming. We will also honor those who have served in leadership as deacons in the past, and we've been hoping to do that for a while, and so we're going to do that on that Sunday. A little closer than October 10th, tonight we have a youth bonfire right out back. We're going to light a fire, have some hot dogs, talk around the fire. If you have young people that are 8th through 12th grade, we'd love for them to come out and join us out there. The men's ministry is cranking up again this coming Saturday, the 18th. They'll meet at 9 o'clock for a Bible study and a time to just kind of share their hearts around the Word. And then at 11, they're going to have a fish fry, so they're going to be cooking and eating. I apologize for those of you whose appetites I've whet. That is just for the fellas that day. They're not going to be, it's not a fundraiser selling plates like our last fish fry. So if you want some ladies, women on mission, you can fry up some fish and knock that out as an opportunity. Scholarship applications are out there as well. And then I am remiss because I didn't take a look at my calendar closely enough. This Tuesday, the 14th of September at 10 a.m., we're going to have Super Senior Game Time. Come and sit around the table, play some games. We're going to have some different card games and board games and puzzles and opportunities to just have some fun. At our planning meeting, several folks said, you know what we need to do? And we said, what's that? And they said, we need to laugh a little bit more because life is pretty heavy. Things are falling down. And we feel most encouraged when we come around the table and hear the laughter of those people that we gather with. So join us at 10 o'clock on Tuesday for Super Seniors if you can. Any other announcements that I have missed? Well, receive now this benediction, a poem about words. As you go, speak out, but speak kindly. Speak boldly, but speak humbly. Speak often, but don't waste your words. Speak passionately, but speak faithfully. Speak the truth, but speak it in love. Speak, but don't forget